are many of our people who are thinking more deeply and more broadly, are looking at it as it actually is, and are beginning to see it more in the international context and the relation that it has with the African struggle, a human rights struggle, or the struggle for human rights. And as such, we can then take it into the United Nations.
Bring about the freedom of these people by any means necessary.
Everyone, welcome to We Charge Colonialism. We are an organization that is seeking to raise awareness of the fact that Africans in the United States are being colonized. We are doing this because we have to raise awareness of this in order to correctly address the situation that we're in as a people. We need to obtain the right to self-determination and not be passive in our organizing, but be purposeful if we're going to actually exist inside of this country without any fear of being attacked or any fear of being a casualty of white supremacy. So that's what our organization is about. If you want to know more about us, you can visit wechargecolonialism.org and also email us at wechargecolonialism@gmail.com if you're interested in joining us. That's what we're about. Let's talk about what's going on in Baltimore. Of course, we know that the COVID-19 coronavirus pandemic is going on, and people have been reacting in all types of ways. This story I felt was very disturbing because it's just another testament of the fact that Africans in the United States, and globally, of course, but in the United States, Africans are completely dispensable to this system, and we're the least prioritized in this system. And this is a testament of it. So I'm going to read from a story. This is on Face to Face Africa, a great news site if everyone wants an African-based site to get updates on things that are going on around the world. So it says, Baltimore Mayor asked residents to stop shooting one another as hospitals will need beds for coronavirus. You guys heard that correctly. The Baltimore mayor asked people to stop killing each other so that we can have beds for the coronavirus. This is so sad, but this is where we're at. So as coronavirus surges, Baltimore Mayor Jack Young has pleaded with residents to stop shooting one another, as hospital beds must be saved to treat patients with the deadly virus. Scores of people were shot Tuesday night in Madison Port as coronavirus spreads in the city. As of Sunday, Baltimore had 24 coronavirus cases, while Maryland authorities recorded 244 across the state. By the way, this story was written on March 23rd, so it's kind of an old story. These numbers are, of course, a lot higher right now than they were before. He said, I want to reiterate how completely unacceptable the level of violence is that we have seen recently, Young was quoted. We will not stand for mass shootings and an increase in crime. For those of you who want to continue to shoot and kill people of this city, we're not going to tolerate it. We're going to come after you and we're going to get you. He continued, we cannot clog up our hospitals and their beds with people that are being shot senselessly because we're going to need those beds for people infected with the coronavirus. And it could be your mother, your grandmother, or one of your relatives. Baltimore officials have been trying hard to respond to the coronavirus and recent violent crimes, including the gun violence on Tuesday night that injured 7 people. All right, so this is sad, of course, and this is, it's kind of, I don't know if it's whether to be appalled by what the mayor said or just said, hey, you have a point. But the fact is, we know, number one, that the coronavirus is killing our people more than anyone else. We know that Black people are being disproportionately killed, and we're being disproportionately exposed to this thing, because if you think about it, I don't know where you guys live, but where I live, if you drive around, you realize that our people are not given the luxury of self-quarantining. Our people don't have the luxury of staying in the house. Our people, if let's say we even want to just do something like get food, a lot of times we're going to places that are not so easy to just stay separate or easy to protect yourselves. Let's say you have to go to work. A lot of times we have to catch public transportation. If we want to go anywhere, we have to take the bus. So we're just more exposed. We have people inside of food pantry lines that are long, and people are being exposed to one another. Our people are inside of a different situation when it comes to this virus already. And of course, we know that the health disparities that exist because African people, again, are colonized. If you want to know another symptom of colonization, it's a failed healthcare system. It's a failed health, a failed level of health across the board. This is another symptom that we are colonized. And this is what's happening every single city where Black people exist, unfortunately. And in Baltimore, we know this is happening. But it's sad that we're kind of in this point because another symptom of colonization is intra-racial violence that is attacking one another. There's a really, really great book if you want to understand Black-on-Black violence. It's Dr. Amos Wilson. He wrote a book on Black-on-Black violence. And to me, I don't know of anyone who hit the nail on the head the way that he hit it. But the reason why Black-on-Black violence, if that's what you call it, intra-racial violence is a more appropriate term, I think. The reason why it is a symptom of colonization is because it's a symptom of a lack of self-actualization. Self-actualization being being able to control the environment around you. So we know if you're colonized, you don't control your community. You don't control your Black. You don't control your hood. You don't control your city. You don't have control over anything. You are a casualty to a system. You're living at the mercy of a system that has gone adverse to your interests all the while. That is the system of colonization if you are living under it. So if you're a person who's living under colonization, you're not able to control your circumstances. Therefore, you feel a lack of control over your day-to-day life. And the issue of self-actualization, being able to manifest something in your life, is that if you're not able to control your life, you're not able to control your circumstances, then you feel like you're not self-actualized. You feel like you're powerless. And powerlessness will create a symptom inside of you where you try to find other ways to exert power. In an instance of African people, our way of trying to exert power is by exerting power over those around us. And in that instance, it could be our family, it could be our children, and a lot of times it's the people on the streets, the Black brothers and sisters who might do things that we perceive to be adversarial. We might have an incentive to unleash something like gun violence on them because of economic reasons or because of gang wars or whatever. But all of this is a symptom of a lack of a feeling of powerlessness, unable to control your own life, unable to control your own reality. Therefore, you find ways to exert power on those around you. So what we have in Baltimore is a very powerless city. I know this. I lived there for some time. A very powerless city, a people who, it's a very Black city, obviously, but it's a black city that the Black residents are not in control of their situation, as we are everywhere we go, right? So what happens a lot of times is that there are a lot of killings in these situations, and in the situation of Baltimore, it's so sad that now we're having to choose between whether or not, you know, grandma has a bid, or whether or not we get control over this Black-on-Black violence phenomenon. It was very interesting. If you were paying attention to the Freddie Gray riots, there was a instance where the Black community kind of came together, the gang communities came together, and there was a truce. And what's very interesting is that after time has gone by, after the cop was found not guilty for murdering Freddie Gray, the level of intra-racial violence in Baltimore City skyrocketed, which is another sign of powerlessness. So you had a situation where people were hopeful, people were coming together, people thought the system was going to change, and when it didn't, what happens? The people were left feeling powerless and found ways to unleash that power that they wanted on one another. This is the situation that exists inside of our communities, and this is a situation that we have to address. We can't address it because of the coronavirus. You know, as much as I understand where the mayor was coming from, you know, this idea of, okay, if you're not going to stop killing each other because you just want to not kill each other and show love to your brother, just stop killing each other because your grandma needs a bed at the hospital. What makes you think that someone who's about to go in someone's life is thinking, let me hold off on this because the coronavirus is going on right now? That doesn't make logical sense. If you're in that type of mindset, the life of yourself is already diminished, because to me, if you're willing to pull a trigger on someone who looks like you, you automatically diminish the value of your own life because your life became dispensable as your brother's life was dispensable. So that wasn't common sense. But we do have to address this issue of powerlessness. We do have to address the issue of interracial violence, but the way that we address it is by organizing and empowering the community. That's going to take a lot of organizing. It's going to take a lot of fighting against a white supremacist system, and it's going to take getting resources to people who have, again, no control over their day-to-day lives. Giving control to people over the day-to-day lives, that is what it's going to take. These pleas and saying, please stop, you know, I never understand, please stop shooting, stop shooting, stop shooting. That's not going to do anything. What's going to do something is changing the dynamics that exist inside of a white supremacist system where Black people do not have control over our resources. We don't have control over our economics. We don't have control over our politics. We are all subject to someone else's authority and someone else's domination. Changing that dynamic, that's what's going to change the system. And that's what's going to stop the senseless murders of our people on a day-to-day basis. I want to end this video by just saying that I hope our people can make this a priority. You know, for me, this has been something I've cared about deeply, intra-racial violence, and obviously I also care when we're killed by the police, but to me, we have to prioritize them the same. Like, we can't have protests, you know, whenever it's someone that's white doing it and say, oh, well, we're doing it because this person is a public servant. Okay, I get that. But the fact is that if we understand the level of self-loathing you have to kill someone that looks just like you, kill someone that came from the same struggle as you, kill someone that is your brother. I don't care what you perceive them as in that moment. That is your brother. That is your sister that you are killing. That is a serious psychological condition that we have to prioritize and that we have to get straightened. I don't understand why we're so passive about this, but we have to understand the level of self-loathing that it takes to kill people. I have a story, I was thinking of covering it. It was a story of, let me just go through it really quickly. It was a five-year-old who was killed, if I can find it. Okay, I can't find it right now, but there was a five-year-old who was killed while he was on the TikTok app, and he was killed by a stray, and he just succumbed to his injury. A five-year-old who was killed by a stray. This is not the first five-year-old. This is not the first child. This is not the first pregnant woman. This is not the first. How many times has it had to happen till we say, you know what? Maybe we really have to take this serious before we take anything else serious, because it's killing more of our people than the cops killing our people. That's just a fact. I don't care what people say, oh, you know, don't try to, you know, equate the two, or don't try to dismiss police violence. This is not a dismissal of police violence. We should absolutely be organized to stop the police from killing our people. But if we're not organized to stop ourselves from killing our people, how on earth do you think we're gonna stop a white oppressor who has been savage inside of this, inside of this struggle, who has been very vehement in his in his desire to oppress us? How do you think we're going to oppose that big system if we can't start with ourselves? These are the types of things that we have to prioritize. So that's all I have on the story. It's sad, you know, that we're put in this situation, but I'm just hoping and praying that this coronavirus is a wake up to our people. Of the fact that we're just not inside of the society that they told us we're in. You know that you're not inside of this society because it's not affecting you the same that it's affecting them. And this is the story of white supremacy across the board. Anytime something happens in that community, it's going to have a different and more elevated effect in our community. So that's all I have on this, you guys. What are your thoughts? And again, we'll recharge colonialism. You can find a lot of more information on us on our website. And of course, visit our Facebook page. That's all I have, you guys. I will see you in the next video.